Okay. Listening to the previous two speakers, I was reminded of the other point about systems thinking, which comes out of Institute for Health Improvement and other systems thinkers, which is that every system is perfectly designed to achieve the results it gets. So if we have a system that generates high levels of poverty and inequality and discrimination and despoliation of the environment, that's because the system is designed to do exactly that, whether intentionally or unintentionally, but that's the way the system works. Anyway, I'm going to be talking about a different kind of gap, and it's one that I think is really important and that we really need to close, and that is the gap between the social determinants of health and what we're calling the ecological determinants of health. So I've led a process for the last 4 or 5 years with the Canadian Public Health Association to identify and discuss the ecological determinants of health. There's three gaps I want to talk about in the next 15 minutes. The disconnect between social and ecological, a gap in our understanding of the Anthropocene, what it is and its impact on the Earth and its impact on health, and the disconnect between our social and economic aspirations and ecological reality. And I want to end with a few thoughts about some ways forward. We've become so fixated on the ecological determinants of social determinants of health that we've neglected the ecological. If you look at the foundational text, Evans, Barrett, and Marmor back in 1990 or so, you won't find the words ecology, ecosystem, sustainability, or any of that language in there. It was purely the social sciences. And so population health was effectively ecologically blind. And yet, the most fundamental determinants of health are these. Not many of us last very long without air, water, and food. The fuel that powers our societies, the materials with which we build our cities, all of that comes from nature. We're protected from UV radiation by the ozone layer. The environment naturally recycles many of our wastes, not all of them, which is why we have a persistent body burden of persistent organic pollutants, all of us, everyone in the room. And we've had for the last 11,000 years, the Holocene, a relatively stable and livable climate that has given us or allowed us to develop agriculture and civilization. And all of that is changing. So these are the fundamental determinants of health, and they interact with and are driven by and feed back on the social determinants of health. And it is not helpful to have a dialogue over here about the ecological and a dialogue over here about the social when they interact, and we need to develop an eco-social approach to thinking about the determinants of health. So welcome to the Anthropocene. If you don't know what the Anthropocene is, essentially, we are entering, it has been suggested, and there's growing proof of it, a new geologic epoch that millions of years into the future, people, will, if there's any people here millions of years into the future, will be able to see the beginning of this ecological epoch, that we are changing the planet so much that we have become such a powerful force of nature. We, in fact, for example, move more sediment and rock than all of the natural processes of erosion on an annual basis around the planet. That makes us a more powerful force of erosion than nature. And it shows up in many other ways. And all of that will show up in the geologic epoch, in the geologic record. So it has been suggested we are entering a new period. Now, this is a little video that I don't have time to show you because it's 3 or 4 minutes and I only have 15. But if you Google Welcome to the Anthropocene YouTube, you'll find it straight away. And in 3 or 4 minutes, it tells the whole story of the Anthropocene, including our responsibility to address this. Some of the key aspects of the Anthropocene, one of the things I want to stress here is that it's not just about climate change. So much of our discussion becomes a discussion of climate change. And I know Courtney's going to be talking about climate change. And climate change is important. But the Anthropocene is actually much bigger than just climate change. And the problem is that all of the things you see up here, we are changing simultaneously, and they all interact with each other, and usually they interact negatively with each other, so they reinforce each other. So climate change and ocean acidification are both driven by CO2 emissions. Also in the case of climate change, by methane. Ozone layer depletion is perhaps the only one of these where we may have had some success in at least halting the process. Whether we've really reversed it remains to be seen. We are depleting key resources, both renewable and non-renewable. The most concerning of those is water, fresh water, and also soil and food lands, and also the oceans, the fisheries. So we are depleting some fundamental sources of our food. Pollution, disruption of the phosphorus and nitrogen cycles, and I'll touch on that a little bit later. And ecotoxicity, which is what I just mentioned, the fact that every single one of us and other mammalian and other species carry a body burden of persistent organic pollutants. We're born now with a body burden of persistent organic pollutants. And in fact, in terms of the Inuit, levels of those pollutants in the breast milk of Inuit women is among the highest in the planet, and they don't live anywhere near the sources of those pollutants. So it gets around the world. And then finally, we have started a human-created sixth great extinction. And so we are eroding the web of life. And what is happening is both the scale of it, but also the rapidity of this change. So this, in geologic terms, is an incredibly rapid process of change that is underway. I don't have time to go into all of this, but this is a process called the Great Acceleration. Again, Google the Great Acceleration, you'll find a lot about it. But a group of Earth scientists who've been putting forward these ideas, this is a set of charts, and these are a dozen different Earth system trends, and I don't know how well it shows up, but towards the right of each graph is a vertical line. That line is 1950. And you will see that for many of these, things have changed very rapidly since 1950. Not in all cases, but in most cases. And so people are suggesting that the Anthropocene began in the 1950s, and that we've seen this massive acceleration in changes in natural systems. These are just Earth systems, a variety of them. One of the other ways we see this is what is called the ecological footprint, which is to say, our impact on the Earth. Now, there is a line across the middle here, a little hard to see, a little faint green line that runs roughly horizontally. That's world biocapacity. So that is the regenerative capacity of the Earth. And as you'll see, since about 1970, we have exceeded the world's biocapacity. It has increased slightly over time, but as you'll see in a minute, not enough to keep pace with human population growth, among other things. About half of the ecological footprint there is carbon. That's that upper gray swath. So we are living beyond the capacity of the planet to sustain us, which is a little troubling when it comes to human health. There's also dramatic inequality in that. The top line is the ecological footprint of high-income countries. The declining line that runs across there is the biocapacity per person. So although biocapacity has slightly increased because of population growth, the biocapacity per person has declined. Towards the bottom, you have middle and low-income ecological footprints. And we need to be roughly where the green and red line intersect. And the high-income countries are going to have to reduce their ecological footprints by 70 to 80% to get there. This is another indicator, a key indicator, the Living Planet Index, a set of populations, vertebrate populations, 14,000 populations monitored for 3,700 species since 1970. And you will see that the Living Planet Index has declined 58% since 1970 and continues to decline. That is the sixth great extinction. Again, there are inequities in that. The top line here, the sort of turquoisey line, that is high-income countries. Their Living Planet Index has actually increased a little bit, 10%. That may be because they'd already done so much damage that they're now in a recovery phase, but it's largely due to the fact that they are exploiting the natural resources of middle and low-income countries and not having to exploit their own resources. And so they're able to repair. Meanwhile, low-income countries at the bottom, they've seen a 58% decline. So we are inequitably distributing all of this, and we are crossing planetary boundaries. This is work out of the Stockholm Resilience Institute and others who are working on this. The red is where we have crossed into an area of increased risk with respect to suspected planetary boundaries. I don't have time to go into the detail of this. The point is that for 9 or 10 key planetary or Earth systems, we are crossing the boundaries into areas of higher risk for 3 of them and into moderate risk for another 3. And we've barely gotten started when you begin to think about what we're trying to do. So this is the disconnect. The disconnect is this. This is what we have. This is how we behave. We don't have a spare 2 or 3 or 4 planets. We'd better learn, and fairly swiftly, how to live within the constraints of one planet. And we're not doing that, and as I said, our current system is perfectly designed not to live within the constraints of one planet. This is the social dimensions of all of this. So this is some key socioeconomic trends of the Great Acceleration. And again, the vertical line towards the right-hand side of each chart is 1950. And these are things such as population, GDP, urban, I can't even read it all from here, large dams, water use, transportation, telecommunications, and so on. So massive growth in all of these, that's what's causing the massive changes in Earth systems that we're seeing. So the social and economic factors and their underlying cultural values that drive them are driving global ecological change. There's a neat little equation that we use in our CPHA report. The process I led for CPHA, looking at all of this. Impact equals population times affluence times technology. All three of those have grown massively since 1950, and those charts, the hockey stick charts that you see, that apply to a lot of social, economic, and environmental conditions. And so we have seen massive impacts. One of the things we did in our report was we looked at, okay, what would that mean over the lifespan of an infant born this year if we had the current growth that we have, and if that infant had the average life expectancy of today. There's no reason to believe they would, because life expectancy is not predictive. It actually is a sort of sophisticated way of measuring the average age of death of the people who died this year. But anyway, if they lived 80 years, a 1% annual growth in population is a doubling of impact. And then a 3% annual growth is, I couldn't actually read what that sign said. Is a tenfold increase over 80 years. Put those two together, you have a 23-fold impact increase over the lifespan of that child. Anyone here think that's sustainable? Even if our technology improved 5-fold in efficiency, not sustainable. As Kenneth Boulding said, anyone who believes in indefinite growth in anything physical on a physically finite planet is either mad or an economist. And he should know, he'd been president of the American Economic Association, among other things. So very quickly, some ways forward, and I'm going to have to skip through this. Key point, ecosystems sustain societies that create economies. It does not work the other way around. We keep acting as if it did work the other way around. Forget about the economy. We proposed in our report an eco-social model for public health action, where we have to understand the interactions of the ecological and natural systems and the social systems and how they feed back and forth to each other and how they independently and together affect the health of populations. I'm not going to go into the problems of GDP. The only thing one can say about gross domestic product is it's gross when it comes to trying to measure progress. And Simon Kuznets, who invented it largely, said that the welfare of a nation can scarcely be inferred from a measure of national income, but we act as if it could. I'm more interested in this, the Happy Planet Index, which actually measures well-being, life expectancy, adjusts it all for inequality of outcomes, and then expresses it per ecological footprint unit. That would be a much more sensible measure of progress, and I'm doing some work to do that regionally in Victoria and with colleagues in Australia and the UK now. So we have to move to what is called one planet living. But the trick is, how do you move to one planet living while maintaining a high quality of life and good health for all? And we have some thoughts about how to do that, but we're a long way from being able to do that. Wales, interestingly enough, has a Wellbeing of Future Generations Act. Why don't we have a Wellbeing of Future Generations Act, Minister Bennett? Why don't we do this? They can do it. One Wales, one planet. That's their plan. So we're now trying to do this at a regional level. What would our community be like and what would our lives be like if we reduced our ecological footprint to one while maintaining a high quality of life? This, I think, is the work of population and public health in the rest of this century. Thank you.